Afternoon, whenever it is that you're watching this, good evening, middle of the night, and so on. I am sorry to be doing this through a camera because I'd rather do it in person and do my performance. The first thing I'm going to do is remove this. And I would like to be, I would prefer to be at Berkeley now and giving this lecture late in the afternoon on Saturday, and most important, going to drink afterwards. So, sorry that this has happened. Promise to you that there will be a world without coronavirus and without Trump soon, and we will be back to normal. I would like to acknowledge this great honor that you have bestowed upon me. I am very conscious of how important and significant this is for me, and I want to thank the Medieval Academy, Lisa Fagan-Davis, but most of all, Maureen Miller, who I am sure had a lot to do with this. So, let's begin. And there is a lot of light here, and I will send the slides together with the lecture when we forward them to you. And as you can see, the title is there, and it is a long and complicated title. And then the next slide. And I want you to imagine that you are really at Berkeley, because actually the lecture coincided with the date in which I was supposed to deliver it, with the anniversary of the birth of Santa Teresa of Avila. And so I wanted to make that connection. So imagine yourselves going into a slumber in the room in Berkeley, late in the afternoon, on the 28th of March. And here is the lecture. Exactly 505 years ago, on 28 March 1515, Teresa of Avila was born in her eponymous city, a mere 23 years after the edict expelling Jews from Spain on 31st March 1492. And there is a slide of Santa Teresa of Avila, the great Bernini sculpture, in the Church of Santa Maria della Vittoria in Rome, which I saw this fall when I was in Rome for 2 months. Until then, Avila had long been a refuge for Jews, Muslims, and conversos, fleeing from the harshness of inquisitorial persecution elsewhere. The city offered the possibilities of refashioning one's life and religious identity. Such was the case of one Sanchez de Toledo, a converso accused of Judaizing by the Inquisition. His effigy was humiliatingly displayed in one of Toledo's churches, leading him to move to Avila. So was the case of his son, Alfonso Sanchez de Toledo de Cepeda, successful wool merchant, one of Avila's wealthiest men, and a witness to municipal decisions. He married into an old Christian family and purchased a patent of nobility. So was the case with Alfonso's daughter, Santa Teresa of Avila, who became the quintessential 16th century saint, mystic, and eventually patron of Spain. And here is the city of Avila. And in fact, this street called Brieva is the area where the Jewish neighborhood was. This trajectory from inquisitorial persecution to sainthood, from suspected social affiliation to nobility, was certainly possible elsewhere in the Spanish realms, but nowhere were these opportunities as available as in Avila. The ability of Juan Sanchez de Toledo's descendants to refashion their identity occurred in the context of the city's history of dealing, with these religious minorities. Founded in 1088 at the vanguard of the Christian frontier and girded by magnificent walls, the city was never the site for systemic religious violence, forced conversion to Christianity, and or attacks against conversos, so frequent elsewhere after the mid-14th century. And here we have the magnificent walls of Avila. While these antagonisms reached a peak in 1391 and the 1440s throughout Castile, Avila's Jews and conversos did not suffer the brunt of these attacks, nor did the city witness the anti-Muslim restrictions found in other peninsular towns. True, the so-called Holy Child of La Guardia's inquisitorial blood libel trial saw its tragic denouement in 1491 outside the walls of Avila. when 3 Jews and 6 conversos were executed. True, the city Jewish communities had to seek royal protection against persecution after the 1491 executions and during the month before the Edict of Expulsion on 31 March 1492 and the departure in early August. Yet between the mid-13th century and 1492 for the Jews and the early 16th century for the Muslims, there is no evidence of a high level of interreligious violence in Avila. As such, the city does not fully fit into the so-called lacrimosa school's views of Jewish life or into the optimistic reading of religious relations by others, the so-called convivencia, often rosy descriptions. In that sense, Avila fits far better into the recent nuanced analysis of Jewish-Muslim-Christian relations found in David Nirenberg, Remy Constable, Mark Meyerson, Hussein Fancy, Tom Barton, Brian Catlos, and others. In the 2 centuries before the Jewish expulsion in 1492 and the forced conversions of Muslims to Christianity in the early 16th century, the three religious groups commingled in Avila's street, traded with each other, and lived in close proximity to the religious others. Until the early part of the 14th century, the archival evidence shows Muslims and Jews selling mostly urban real estate to the cathedral chapter. After that, they mostly lease, what they call censos in Spanish, properties belonging to the chapter. They enjoy a strong grip on the city's artisan trades and petty mercantile activities. Muslim, mudejas, if we are going to use the right terminology, also played a vital role in Avila's hinterland agricultural activities. In addition, Jews and conversos flocked to the city after the 1391 and 1440s violence. With no inquisitorial tribunal until 1490, the city was certainly a far safer place for Jews, Muslims, and conversos than other peninsular towns. Because of the limitations of time, I focus on a specific time period, the second half of the 15th century, when religious antagonisms were on the rise in Castile, centering these presentations on 3 case studies. They serve as lenses through which to explore the complexities of intra-religious relations, the opportunities for coexisting and sharing an urban space, the processes available for changing one's identity and for assimilation. And yes, the antagonisms and litigations that existed in Avila as they did elsewhere. Here I emphasize the local context. As Mark Bloch is famously attributed to have said, the history of the Middle Ages was a history of localities. So it is for the relations between Jews, Muslims, and Christians in Iberia. Avila does not stand for the whole of Castile or Spain. Or to the contrary, the city was quite unusual. The case of Avila shows that religious minorities and foreigners could gain a foothold within Christian society, or at least to do so for a while. Located on the high plains of Old Castile, a mere 88 kilometers northwest of Madrid, the city commanded a strategic position on a road network that connected Avila with Toledo, which had been conquered in 1085, Salamanca, and cities far north. Avila and its regions' economic activity centers around the transhumans, with probably between 3,000 to 4,000 urban inhabitants around 1300, Avila's poor soil and inhospitable weather were not fully conducive to agriculture, but, as was the case throughout Castile and the medieval West, cereal grains and vineyards, the first required as the main payment for feudal rents, and the second for liturgical needs and hospitality, were integral parts of Avila's economy. It was not overall a rich place, but its ecclesiastical and urban elites garnered substantial income from land rents, the transhumans, rental of urban property, and the profitable military role in the reconquest. Despite the similarities to other frontier towns in Old Castile, Avila was different. The city became a haven, if that word can be used for the status of religious minorities in late medieval Castile, for Jews and Muslims until the final expulsion and or forced conversion. Avila was also a refuge for conversos fleeing persecution elsewhere and seeking to fashion or refashion a new identity. This was most pointedly the case in Avila's relations to Toledo, a city that witnessed violent anti-converso riots in the 1440s and the most active inquisitorial tribunal after 1478. A good number of these conversos forged new lives in Avila, thus Santa Teresa and her family. What then made Avila so special? In the conclusion to these presentations, I will attempt to provide some answers to these questions, but now we must look at the evidence. Numbers matter. As the 1483 list of Avila's Jews and Muslims' contributions to the crown showed, the number of Jews and Muslims in Avila was considerable. 264 Jews were named as head of household, or an equivalent of over 1,000 Jews, and most probably a figure close to over 1,200, when one considers a 4.5 coefficient for demographic calculations, or Jews too poor to contribute. Their assessments of donkeys carrying full loads of barley, agricultural utensils, and payments for men to serve in the Granada front, or the monetary equivalent, represented a significant addition to the royal coffers. More than two decades ago, Serafin de Tapia examined the extant records for Jewish fiscal obligations. He calculated between 264 and 285 as the number of Jews' heads of household. But he used a coefficient of only 3.7 to calculate the number of individual Jews in 1483. I do not think this multiplier reflects the actual size of Jewish families in the period, as other sources often show much larger families. Regardless of whether we choose the larger or lower number, the tax records confirm that the Jewish population of Avila was the largest in late 15th century Castile. Muslims paid the same type of taxes as did the Jews, though at a lesser rate. Avila's Muslims had to support peones, or foot soldiers, contribute barley, as well as pack animals, and the payments were to be coordinated with those of the Jews and the Christians. 118 Muslims are listed, with the possibility that a number of Muslims living in Avila's hinterland and engaged in agricultural work, as we know from the records, may not have been included. The number was probably also close to 530 plus individuals by using a 4.5 coefficient. Since Avila's total population would probably not have exceeded 5,000 altogether by 1450, plus others, mostly Christians and Mudéjars, living in the city's extensive hinterland, if these figures hold, and medieval demography is at best a guessing game, then religious minorities would have represented, as the Tapia has argued, at a minimum 23% of the entire population of the city and its countryside, and probably, as I suspect, a larger percentage. The list of contributors also reflected the uneven wealth of Jews and Muslims and social hierarchies within both communities. Wealthier individuals in either Alhama were responsible to pay for more. Contributors were listed into groups of 4 to 6 taxpayers, that is, people who became responsible collectively for a specific contributions, the ones that I already mentioned, donkeys laden with barley, a peon, 2/3 of a peon, and so forth. Significantly, Jews and Muslims represented the lion's share of the city's contributions to the crown's war effort. Serafin de Tapia has argued that while Christian taxpayers or pecheros, not everyone was liable for taxes either because of poverty or privilege, represented 75% of all those contributing, they pay only 33% of the assessed taxes. Jews, representing 17 of the taxpayers, contributed 44.3%, while Muslims, only 8% of the taxable population, contributed 22.2% to the entire sum to be collected from Avila by the Catholic monarchs. The Tapia's calculations raise some significant questions and provide valuable leads. Jews and Muslims, while only 23% of the active paying tax population, contributed 66.5% of the total tax assessment. The numbers, as I argued earlier, may have been greater. But even taking the Tapia's numbers as conclusive, more than one of every five Avila inhabitants was either a Jew or a Muslim. Furthermore, the high percentage of what religious minorities contributed as compared to the Christian payments provide us with another clue as to why Avila's municipal officers may not have been too eager to get rid of them. Although centered on three case studies, we have numerous examples that illustrate the city's usual policy of live and let live. Avila's late 15th century rich documentation, whether already published or still extant in the archives, provides overwhelming evidence. Besides cathedral documents, most of them leases of properties or long-term rent censors, where Jews and Muslims had an important presence as renters, there are elaborate municipal records, notarial registers, what they're called protocolos in Spanish, and royal documents. These sources show the Muslims and Jewish communities' engagement in the daily life of the city. The large numbers and economic activities are, of course, amply confirmed by the 1483 tax census mentioned above. In addition to the frequent appeals to the Crown for protection against municipal fiscal demands and against Christian violence in the wake of the so-called Holy Child of La Guardia Inquisitorial case, Avila Jews and Muslims had other forms of agency. They were always ready to litigate against the city municipal body in defense of the privileges and tax exemptions. The Catholic monarchs, above all Queen Isabella, often responded positively to their appeals even after the 1492 Edict of Expulsion and until the day stipulated for the leaving the Spanish realms. The sources clearly show thriving Jewish and Muslim communities with important economic roles, as well as suggestive vignettes of converso Jewish relations and glimpses into their individual lives in the 15th century. Here, for the sake of brevity, and to provide some broader context before proceeding with my three case studies, I focus on three extensive documentary sources: Alfonso González de Bonilla's notarial register, and two descriptive catalogs, Pilar León Tello's extensive catalog listing all Jews in Avila's documentary sources, and the other of Avila's protocol or notarial registers. As to the first, it has 630 entries for the period between 17 June 1465 and 5 August 1468. 26 Jews are mentioned in the 3 years span covered by the register. Half of them, men and women alike, are described as vecinos, that is to say, someone who has residence and contributes to the town tax levies. In fact, in other sources, Jews and Muslims were almost always identified as vecinos, and only exceptionally as a Jew of Avila or a Moor of Avila. The honorific Don and Doña are often used as well. As to Muslims, 34 of them are also named in Bonilla's register, with almost half of them described as vecinos and some as maestres, masters of the trade, with the urban and rural occupations often included in the documents. This estimate of the number of Jews and Muslims mentioned in the documentation does not include a substantial portion of people who, because of their names, identify as coming from another location, as for example Pedro de Bejar, may have been conversos or who were explicitly identified as such. This was the case of Pedro Núñez, converso, Diego Álvarez de Sotomayor, converso, and vecino de Ávila, Lope González, converso, and many others, including Muslim converts or Moriscos. In León Tello's inventory, 484 entries, and in the notarial registers, 2,104 documents, hundreds of Jews and Muslims appear leasing houses and other properties and paying rent to the city's cathedral chapter. Many, as mentioned above, were described as vecinos or identified by the honorific Don or Doña. Rabbis, cantors, and synagogues are also identified. So were Jewish butcher shops, Carnicería de los Judíos, stores, and evidence for a wide variety of trades. Furthermore, although by the 15th century there were identifiable Jewish and Muslim neighborhoods, the Juderia, the Alhama, Jews and Muslims continue to inhabit areas of mixed Christian, Jewish, and Muslim populations. Jews, as had been the case before, purchase and sold property, including rural property, such as orchards. They also made property exchanges with Muslims, often their neighbors in terms of urban inhabitation patterns, and often equally harassed by the Christian majority. The presence of conversos, whether identified directly or suspected, because of the names and activities, illustrates the changing realities of Jewish life after 1391 and the permeability of the boundaries between Jews and conversos. A few examples may serve to document this later point in greater detail. In a longer version of this paper, I have a large number of examples that illustrate the liminal position of religious minorities in Avila and the close relationship between conversos and Jews. Here, for the sake of brevity, I mention only a few. On 2 July 1460, two Jewish rabbis, Yosef and Meir, were compensated with 370 maravedis for their work as doctors to the cathedral chapter. Rabbis keeping the canons of cathedral chapter safe and healthy. What could be more ironic than that? Yet on the same day, another document tells us that the services were no longer needed, as Pedro Núñez de Toledo, a converso from nearby Toledo, had assumed their obligations. In spite of that, Yosef and Meyer were still tending to the canons 5 years later, receiving 500 maravedis for their quarterly salary in 1465. In 1466, a Jew, upon converting to Christianity and taking the name Pedro, received 300 maravedis for a cape as a reward for his embracing of Christianity, indicating the possibility of monetary reward, even if in kind, for conversion. I want to move now to the three case studies. And the first one begins with Muslims, and this is a kind of representations of Muslims in the Cantigas de Santa Maria. Muslims played an active role as tile and brick makers. The transactions with Avila's cathedral chapter and other ecclesiastical establishments in the city and its hinterland illustrate the close connection between different religious communities. On 25th October 1465, Abdallah de la Calle and his wife Jacota agreed to give 100 good tiles, well made and bien cochas, well baked, and this is all quotes from the document, to Juan Gutierrez. The tiles had to be delivered by late May of the following year at the latest, with a fine of 350 maravedis to be paid for failure to do so. Several people serve as witnesses to the transactions, including a sheep herder from Atizadera or Atizadoro, a place in Avila's hinterland, and identified by the existence of a kiln, so probably the place where the tiles and the bricks were made. And here is a list of the names that will appear among the Muslim tile and brick makers. Abdallah's family, if one may identify king groups by their surnames, held an important place in Avila's Muslim community. Maestre Cale or Cal de la Calle served as the Muslim Alhama's procurator, responsible for apportioning the fiscal obligations of the community in 1483. Other members of the family, Hamed, Cale's son, Alicaro de la Calle, and Yosef de la Calle were listed first in the Crown Status Assessment in 1483. These are the most important members of the Muslim Alhama in Avila. Abdallah's connection with the Caro family is central to the social location of the family. Alicaro's and his relatives, this is another Alicaro, though probably related, were the leading Muslim family in Avila. For more than a century, they held a leading role in the city. On 1st April of the following year, 1466, Abdallah Contuerso, a Moor and Vecino citizen of Avila, also agreed to provide 1,000 roof tiles and 1,500 bricks, again todo bueno and bien cocho, all good and well baked, to Alfonso de Avila, archdeacon of the cathedral chapter. The tiles were due at the end of the month, and the bricks were to be delivered the following year. Several vecinos of Avila served as witness to the contract, including the archdeacon's squire, Don Nuno González del Águila. Similar to Abdala de la Calle, Abdala Contuerzo counted on extensive family connections in the city. The Contuerzo name, with its many variations in spelling, appears in Avila's documentation throughout most of the 15th century. Three of them are named in the 1483 tax list, among the first seven names recorded: Muhammad, Algath, and his brother Abdallah, probably a different Contuerzo than our tile maker. In 1449, Algath Contuerzo agreed with other Christian participants to the appointment of Diego González de Dueñas as arbiter for a dispute over the selling of hides in a nearby Talavera butcher shops, which shows a kind of mobility and reach of these Muslim communities beyond Avila into the whole area around Toledo. In 1487, Abdallah, the range of names was quite small, identified now as a son of Algath, most probably the previous name Algath, and vecino de Avila, acknowledged a debt of 10 castellanos to none other than Alicaro, who in this and other transactions is identified as a money lender. All are described as moros and vecinos, Moors and citizens of Avila. These two tile and brick makers' story provide us with a window, as small as it may be, on Muslim life in Avila. First, Yakota, a Muslim wife, was similar to Christian spouses, an equal partner in the business, and fully responsible financially for the transactions undertaken in unison with her husband. Second, although probably operating the business in the city's hinterland, at least one of the Muslims named in this transaction was a citizen of Avila, with all the rights and privileges that such citizenship conferred. Third, the two men were closely connected with some of the city's leading Muslim kin network, including the Cairo King Group. In fact, as large as the Jewish and Muslim communities were, we must think of them as extended family groups. Fourth, the tile and brick manufacturers catered to the ecclesiastical institutions, engaged, as the evidence seems to suggest, in the building, rebuilding, and maintenance of ecclesiastical buildings, including the cathedral. Other examples show the Mudéjar's role in the building industry, often reflecting the cathedral chapter or desire for the upkeep of the urban properties. Some of the Muslims living in Avila in the second half of the 15th century, it should be noted, must have been quite wealthy or held extensive properties. On 4 November 1465, Giuseppe de Palacios, his wife Fatima, and probably a nephew named Ali, all of them identified as vecinos de Avila, agreed to pay 2,000 maravedis to Juan Gutierrez, a canon in the cathedral chapter, for the rent, which was 2 years in arrears, of an orchard huerta. The amount, a partial payment was far beyond Avila's average house or orchard price. Unless the transaction marked a different kind of exchange, perhaps money lending, this was the highest price paid for rent in late medieval Avila. Finally, complementing the manufacturing and trade jobs, Muslims often engaged in agricultural activities, selling grain, or sometimes paying the census for the rural holdings in grain. And now we move to the second case study, which is that of a Florentine painter in Avila. And this is a kind of representations of foreigners, merchants, pilgrims, in 13th and 14th century iconographic details. And then, of course, this is a view of poor Florence now assailed by the virus, where the people that I'm going to speak about were born. When we turn to our second case study, we enter a very different world from that of religious minorities, even though our main protagonists maintain a close relation with Jewish craftsmen. This brief account focuses on a Florentine painter, Sansón was his name, and his brother Nicolas painter. And again, we have the slide of Florence. Sansón, but not his brother, was a painter of some talent, While there is no evidence of his work or of him in Italy, we have one of his rather good extant paintings in Avila's Cathedral Museum, and you could see essentially both the family of Sansón, born in Florida, and one of his paintings, which reflects a great deal of Renaissance influence. We know that Sansón migrated to Avila sometimes toward the mid-15th century, and his brothers either accompanied him or followed shortly afterwards. The former married a Castilian woman, settled in Avila, and prospered in the late 15th century. The extant documentation shows at least 18 references to Sansón's activities in Avila, and from them we learn about his life, his family, and his successes. Married to Marina López, their son Diego was most probably still a minor in 1465. That year, Sansón, acting on his behalf, agreed to litigate a case in front of the Archbishop of Santiago. Although we do not know what the litigation was all about, the fact that it was settled by such a lofty figure do give us some clues as to his standing in Avila's social world and his connections to ecclesiastical establishments in the city and beyond. Besides his artistic and supervisory work for the cathedral and other churches to be described below, he also received an ecclesiastical benefice in the Church of the Santa Cruz in Castellanos de la Dehesa. After receiving, and I quote, apostolic permission to accept benefices and prestamos or loans, close quotes, Sansón claimed his benefice at a ceremony carried in the church, quote, with doors closed, end of quote. The remarkable thing about this ecclesiastical grant, perhaps granted as payment for his work decorating the church, was that roughly a year and a month afterwards, Sansón renounced it for the benefits of the Archbishop of Toledo. Other documents provide us with clues to his domestic and family life. In 1466, Sansón, described here as a Florentine painter as opposed to later descriptions also as a vecino of Avila, and his wife Marina agreed to provide bridal clothing for the wedding of the criada, Juana, Ferran Martín's daughter. Alfonso, the groom-to-be, was to pay for the food and drinks to be served at the wedding party. Criada may be translated as servant today, but in the medieval Castilian context, it meant a dependent brought up in the household and married from your house, a kind of extended family. She was important enough to the Sansón household that the following year they litigated against Juana's uncle, Pedro Fernández de Palacio, forcing him to convey goods and property to Juana that Pedro had kept illegally. As to Nicolás, Sansón's brother and also a painter, we have only one single reference, but it gives us a clue to the role of these second great Florentine painters in Avila. On 13 April 1466, a couple, vecinos of the Avila, entered into a contract with Nicolás for the apprenticeship of the son Francisco as a painter. As revealing as these bits of information are, the real story here is that of Sansón commissions for artwork in Avila, his partnership with local painters, and his close working relation with Jewish craftsmen. And here we have a slide which will be accompanying this presentation of Sansón's relation to Jewish. This is the people that we talk about and the painting, and now here are the Jews that he worked with. Jews had a visible role in the production of religious art, with Sansón either as an intermediary between the Jews and their ecclesiastical clients, as a collaborator, or as a supervisor of the work. On 6 July 1468, Isaac Efaro, a Jew and vecino of Avila, agreed with Diego Rodríguez and Diego López, clerics of the Church of San Vicente. San Vicente is the largest church after the cathedral, right outside the walls of Avila, a very beautiful 12th century church, to make a linen canopy for a sepulcher. The very large canopy, called pabellón in Spanish, was to be made in three rather gaudy colors, blue, red, and yellow. Isaac's compensation was 4,000 maravedíes, pointing to the importance and complexity of the work and to the high cost of such large linen cloth, We have the exact measures of the cloth in the document. Sanson was one of the Christian artists supervising the work. He had also worked earlier with another Jewish craftsman on an artistic religious project. In July 1465, Sanson agreed to purchase gold and silver. The quantities are stipulated in the documents from Moshe Denant, a batidor or a gold beater, and son of Don Salomon, to be used in his paintings of building of the Trinity's Church altarpiece. Sanson also worked with Christian painters and accepted commissions both in Avila and his hinterland. All the documentary evidence indicates that his work seems to have been exclusively painting churches, altars, and their other religious art, with no extant proof of any private or secular work. And here we turn to the third case study, which is, of course, the relationship between Jews and conversos. And here we have from the Cantigas de Santa Maria, which is a mid-13th century work, representations of Jews in Castile. I have to add that we know that they did not dress necessarily in the manner prescribed by the law, but they dressed very much like everybody else. The complex nature of Jewish life in Avila is best seen in the economic links that bound Jews and the cathedral chapter. I summarize here the far more elaborate and complex documentary evidence of these fiscal connections. From the 1350s onward, Jews became renters of urban property owned by the cathedral chapter. From the mid-15th century onwards, there is a noticeable shift that illustrates how Jews began to transfer property and long-term leases to others, most probably conversos relatives. This shift in who held property and where in the city that property was held may also reflect changing patterns of inhabitations as Jews and Muslims became increasingly segregated to specific neighborhoods within Avila's wall, the neighborhood that I already mentioned in the street of Brieva, which still exists to this very day. It is within the broader context of this increasing pressure on Jews, and to lesser extent on Muslims, that we must place our final case study. In three successive and interconnected documents in Avila's notarial registers, and all dated on 1st January 1449, Alfonso González de Sigüenza, most certainly a converso, and his wife Marie González, most certainly a converso on one side, and Don Moshe Levy, a clothing merchant and owner of a blacksmith shop, and his wife Reina on the other, and both of them Jews, signed a marriage contract on behalf of their respective children, Isabel and Diego. Alfonso and Maria agreed to pay for the bedding of the daughter Isabel, who was to be married, and the document says, to marry de casar a ley y bendición según manda la Santa Madre Iglesia, that is to say, according to the law and blessings of the Holy Mother Church, to Diego, Don Moses' son. Don Moses was to pay for his son's wedding clothing, but with the condition that Diego was to serve his father as a blacksmith for 2.5 years. Here we witness what we may call a mixed marriage. Diego had either converted to Christianity or was about to do so, while his father remained a Jew. While this seems to have been an amicable agreement, as painful as his son's conversion may have been to Moshe, there was also the economic links to be considered. Though Moshe lost his Jewish son, but at least he secured a worker for his blacksmith's business. And here we have the wedding families, the names of the conversos and the Jews. Thanks to Professor Francisco García Serrano, who teaches in Madrid at San Luis University, who scanned these documents for me in Avila, and to Richard Ibarra, who is at UCLA as one of my graduate students, who helped me a great deal with the 15th century devilish paleography. A closer examination of the document, as opposed to the summaries in the Protocolos catalog, provide additional details that expand our understanding of the fluidity of intra-religious relations in late 15th century Avila. Alfonso González de Sigüenza was Isabel's stepfather. Her real father had been Alfonso de Sarella or Surella, a name far closer to a Converso name than González de Sigüenza. In fact, a Jew named Zach de Surella rented property from the chapter in the early 15th century, and he was probably the father of Isabel's father, that is to say, Isabella's grandfather. As for Gonzalo de Sigüenza, he is described as Pedro Guillén de Sevilla's man, or his hombre, that is, a dependent or an employee. Pedro de Guillén, and there are like 50 plus references to him in the Ávila documentation, served as a farmer of the Atienza soil wells and as a royal agent, a scribe of the royal household in charge of managing and distributing soil to Ávila's market and elsewhere in the regions. He appears prominently in Ávila's documents and quite often as a moneylender. His name, employment, place of origins, and activities make very possible that he was a converso and that he had also been a fiscal royal agent as a Jew. Others appearing in the documentation as witnesses and parties to the wedding contract, such as Fernando González Hebre, Luis González de Toledo, and many others, were vecinos, university trained, letrados, and had connections with Ávila's ruling elite or administrative post. They appear as witness to the first January 1449 documents and were later associated with either Alfonso González de Sigüenza or with Don Moshe Levy as procurator or litigators on their behalf. Most of them also had, as already noted, overlapping roles as letrados, as university graduate litigators, royal agents, and moneylenders, usually in small amounts to Christian Jews and or to each other. A closer look also tells us that Isabel and Diego's respective dowries were substantial, involving clothing and money. All the items are described in detail, as are the penalties for failure to uphold the agreement, as for example, Diego not working for his father. Additional documentary evidence shows the main parties to the wedding agreement renting houses, lending money, giving authorization to others to litigate on their behalf. Diego, while remaining a blacksmith, went on to play a modest role in Ávila society. He borrowed money jointly with his father-in-law from other Christians, most probably conversos. In 1489, Diego, by then an old man, paid for a substitute espingardero, somebody who carry a shotgun or a musket, as part of Ávila's contribution to the campaign against Granada. Diego's brother, Jaco, remained a Jew and a smith, working probably side by side with his converso brother. On 16 March 1450, Jaco, a blacksmith and son of Moshe Levy, gave power of attorney to Alonso Fernández. Where are we to trace every documentary reference to witnesses and others involved with the bride, the groom, and the parents, we will be here forever. Of course, these familiar arrangements were not always peaceful or painless. On 20 August 1449, Luis González de San Juan, a vecino de Ávila, moneylender and converso, gave power to his brother, García Suárez, to litigate for the amount that were due to them from the inheritance of the common brother Solomon and Ben-Hujar and their nephew Abraham, the later two vecinos of Salamanca. In 1480, Juan de San Martín, vecino de Ávila, brought a suit against his brother Moshe Hasei, a vecino in one of Ávila's hinterland rural locations. The legal dispute centered on the distribution of the father's inheritance. One must assume that the father was a Jew, and now his two sons, standing on opposite religious corners, fought over the inheritance. Many other such disputes are recorded in Ávila documentation. One magnificent one is earlier in the 15th century, which is why I didn't include it here, but I want to tell you that, in which a couple, well, we don't know if it is a couple or a brother or a sister, he is a Jew, she is a Christian, and they agree to hire two Muslim carpenters to put a wall in the house that they held in common to divide the house into two different houses. She took an oath on the Gospels and he took an oath on the Torah, the law, the document says the law that God had given to the Jews in Mount Sinai. In the wake of the inquisitorial trial and the burning of Jews and conversos outside of Avila, the so-called Holy Niño de la Guardia trial, there were flare-ups of violence against Avila's Jews, prompting an edict placing the Aljama of Avila under royal protection on 16 December 1491. It is a tragic irony that the same rulers who protected Avila's Jews in December issued the edict of expulsion on 31st March 1492, bringing an end to Jewish life in the entire peninsula. Shortly after the edict, a number of Jews relinquished their lease houses, either donating them to Christians, conversos relatives most probably, or selling the property. Between 31st March and June 20, 24 such transactions were recorded. After 1492, only the names of former Jewish areas of activities survived, a vanishing memory of more than four centuries of Jewish presence in the city. Before concluding, I return here to the question on whether Avila was a far more benign, if such a word had any currency in the Middle Ages, place for religious minorities than other locations throughout the peninsula. And if so, why? Even if the examples shown above seem to indicate that such was the case, there is nonetheless no single satisfactory explanation. The social and economic structures of Avila's ruling elite made the city more lenient on matters of religious difference. This was neither tolerance nor convivencia. In addition, the small size of the city, of the areas within the walls, and the limited extent of urbanization extramuros led to a commingling and familiarity not possible in larger towns. Furthermore, since Avila's urban and rural ruling groups derived most of their income from land rents and the transhumans, Jews and Muslims fulfilled necessary roles in artisan and small mercantile operations. They were important for the city and the cathedral chapter's economic well-being. They were not seen as economic competitors. Avila's ruling urban elite had close ties with the cathedral chapter, which they controlled, with vested financial interests in the presence of Jews and Muslims in the town and its hinterland. As renters and workers, religious minorities were an important economic component of the cathedral chapter's fiscal strategies. It is precisely the ecclesiastical nature of Avila's life intramuros that allow for fairly free exchanges and for a low level of violence. The presence of Jews and Muslims as farmers, masons, artisans, doctors, and the like was indispensable until religious orthodoxy trumped economic interest. There are, of course, other reasons, but Avila, unlike other northern Castilian towns, remained a place where Jews and Muslims could live, work, and worship with some semblance of peace, again not convivencia, until the very end. It allowed foreigners like Sansón to become Castilians. It allowed Muslims to manage profitable business by tending to the needs of the church. It allowed for conversos from Toledo to refashion their identity. It allowed for Teresa of Avila, and here he is again, to become a mystic and a saint. Life in Avila was complicated. Many thanks. After putting up with this for so long, I think you deserve to go and have a very tall glass of wine. Thank you very much. Be well.